in Bavaria, Germany, is it? We took advantage of that opportunity, didn't you? That was a bold move. And that seems like it was just yesterday, and I think it almost was just yesterday, actually. Yeah, we thought, you know, maybe 2016, you know? But you don't waste any time, do you? No. We're having a wedding, right? 2015, September 2000. That's awesome, though, because when you know God's in it, why wait, right? Right? And I know there was an individual who was on an airplane with you 2 years ago who probably thought you could have gotten married a little sooner, because I don't know if anybody knows this, but Jessica was on a trip a couple of years ago and to Spain, and there was a nice young man who was trying to, I don't know if he was young or not, but he was trying to help her get her bags out of the overhead compartment, and I don't know if she didn't like that or what, but he left that interaction with a bloody nose and his glasses broken. And Jessica's excuse for that, for her doing that to him, was, "This is the first time I've traveled alone." Which makes complete sense. I usually do that when I travel alone for a good time. But he probably wished that you guys would have been married back then, so you would have been traveling around. See what I did there? But I know it is Jessica and Dylan's heart that God be glorified. That's why they're coming together. And it's a lot of fun. It's a lot, brings me great pleasure, guys, to see where your hearts are at and what you are desiring God to do in and through your lives. And that's the purpose for today, that God would receive all the glory. And you see, there's a lot of confusion that's out there in our world today. And it's because of this very fact, that we believe life is all about us. Life gets complicated when we believe life is truly all about us. But for the people who come to realize that this time that we have here on this earth is not truly about us, but has everything to do with the Creator of absolutely everything, and that it's all for Him, that everything that is done is for His honor and for His glory. And those who find that begin to walk in true joy, true freedom. Because then God can take every situation that happens in life. We can take those situations and say, "I'm not sure why this is taking place right now in my life. And yet, I can rest assured that God is going to use this for His honor and for His glory." Amen? And this is what God desires to do. So those who come to understand that, I'm going to look at a passage. I'm going to look at three different passages here today. Psalm 115, verse 1, starts off, I believe, beautifully for what your guys' heart's desire is here today. "Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but to your name give glory." Not unto us, not unto us, but to your name give glory. Why? Because of your mercy. And because, remember that, because of your mercy and because of your truth. Because of your mercy and because of your truth. Friends, we hold in our hands here today, I'm holding anyways in my hand here right now, truth. Absolute truth. And I want to let you in on something that there's many terms, many phrases that have been thrown around even in evangelical circles, then we adapt them as truth theology. But I want to let you know that what you see in many cases, you'll find a very different representation of God if you were to open up your Bible and read. A true revelation of who God is. I think for many of us, it would absolutely shock us. But the problem is, in many times in our day, we don't like to read the Word of God, and we just simply take people's word for it. And I want to encourage everybody here this afternoon, get your Bible out. Get your Bible out. Not right now. I'm going to finish this here today. We're going to do this. We're going to celebrate here today. But get your Bibles out and begin to read it. And begin to take it for face value. And come. My prayer would be that each one of us would encounter the true living God of the Bible. Amen? Because this is a God that does incredible things. This is a God that absolutely transforms. And so, here's he lists a question. This is very common, I think, in our day. And he says here in verse 2, why should Gentiles say, where is their God? We often hear questions about God, especially in the day and age that we're living in, don't we? If God is real, if God actually exists, then why in the world is he allowing these different things to be taking place in the different places of the world? You've probably asked some of these quick questions yourself. Maybe even right here this morning. If God is love, then why this? If God is absolutely caring, then why this? Why has this happened in my life? If God truly is who you say he is. And so this question is going to be asked of you guys, Dylan and Jessica, in your lifetime. And you know what the cool thing is about the Word of God? It has answers, right? It has answers. I want to give you an answer that you can share with people when they ask you, where's God? If God is real, then why is this happening? And all the questions that go along with that. Here's what it says, verse 3. But our God is in the heavens. It doesn't stop there, though. It goes on. This is good for us, though. Our God is in the heavens, and this is what he's doing. He's doing absolutely whatever he pleases. How do you like that? How do you like that this morning, this afternoon? And my first thing that I would like to say to you guys, with any piece of advice that I could give you, is make no apologies for God. God doesn't need you to make apologies for him. God doesn't need you to defend him. He's God. He's okay. Right? And he is in absolute control. And his word tells us that he does absolutely everything that he pleases. And we can take the time, and we won't hear this morning, but go through scripture after scripture. Say, wow, God does that? Wow, that was God's response to Job after he had lost everything? Dress yourself like a man? And I got some questions for you. How many of us would like that this morning? The God of the universe to sit us down and say, I got a couple questions for you. You got a couple questions for me? I got a couple questions for you. Who are you to answer to God on whether he should do this, that, or the next thing? And so make no apologies for the God of the Bible. Don't try to tame him. Don't try to tame God. Don't try to get him in a cute little box and make him more palatable, make him more presentable. So often in the church today, that's happening. And what's the result of that is a lack of power. Because they're presenting a false Jesus. And the gospel has power. We know that from Romans 1:16. Not being ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God. It's salvation for everyone who believes. So make no apologies for him. Number 2, be people of the word, not stuck on man's ideas. Be people of the word, not stuck on man's idea. This response here, I want to do a little exercise with everybody real quick. We got a little exercise here. Can we all do a little exercise together? I want you to inhale as big of an inhale as you can, and then exhale, everybody all together. Ready? 1, 2, 3. And now let it out. Let's do it again, because that was kind of fun. I want to let you know something here this morning, that the God that we're talking about here this morning gave me that breath. Creator of absolutely everything. You want to know how dependent we are upon him? We're dependent upon him for our next breath. We're dependent upon him on whether we make it through this ceremony or not. Pretty dependent, aren't we? And yet he gives that to us. Simply out of something that's called common grace. This is the God that we're talking about here this morning. Do we have some questions for him? Here's the deal. This God that we're talking about here this morning is creator, ruler over everything. I want you to let you know he's not up for election. He's not up for election. No matter how you feel about God, he's not up for election. Guess what else? God does not have a suggestion box. You know that this morning? God does not have a suggestion box for us to be able to say, you know, God, I think if I were in charge, I would do things this way. And he would probably respond something like, and that's exactly why you're not in charge. Amen? Can I get an amen for that one? A lot of people believe that when they see God, they have a couple things to talk to him about. Isaiah 6 is a passage where Isaiah comes into the presence of God. And he sees God for who he is. And I believe that this is the when people see the glory of God, a desire within your hearts for God to be glorified. Well, Isaiah walked into the absolute reality of that in a real way. And his first response was, cursed am I. I'm undone. Because it said, he said, for my eyes have seen the glory of the King. And when you see the glory of the King, your attention goes off of asking him certain questions, and your attention goes on how undone you are to be in his very presence. That's a reality that's going to set in. Some people ask the question, how could a good God, a loving God, send people to an eternal hell for all of eternity? And yet, I think when we see God, I really believe this, that won't be the question. I believe when we see God, if there's a question that we have, it will be this. How in the world can any wretch like me ever be in heaven? How can anybody be in heaven? For which God has an answer through his word. Amen? He has an answer for that. But I think the question changed. I think that becomes the right question. I believe that's the question that we need to start with. We see ourselves for who we are. We see how great and grandiose God is. We respond to him. Well, here's what the Word of God says in Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 9. In this reality that God does whatever he pleases. Here's what Jeremiah chapter 9. Verse 23 says, thus says the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, let not the mighty man glory in his might, nor let the rich man glory in his riches, but let him who glories, glory in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord, exercising loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth. For in these I delight, says the Lord. This is good news, Dylan and Jess. This is good news. I'm glad God does absolutely everything that he pleases. And one of the things that he's pleased to do is show loving kindness. And that's our only hope. Is that God delights in showing loving kindness. That's the only hope for you, Dylan. That's the only hope for you, Jess. It's my only hope. Every single person that's in this room right now, this is their only hope. Is that we're talking about a God who delights in showing loving kindness. And that he gives people the opportunity to repent, to turn from their sins, and turn wholeheartedly to God. I want to close with this, just to give us a little glimpse of the heart of God. It's found in Luke chapter 15. Probably heard of it often, the story of the prodigal. A son who asked his father for his inheritance. Before his father died, what was he saying by that? He was saying, in essence, he was saying, God, or Father, I want your stuff, not you. I'd rather have you dead and have your things, my inheritance, than to truly be with you. And so he went off, and the Bible tells us that he squandered everything. Everything that he had been given, he had wasted on crazy living. With nobody who could say anything to him about the way that he was living that was going to make any difference. And yet, the Bible says he came to his senses. He came to himself. He began to think, as he was in a pigsty, nothing, looking at the food that the pigs were eating, saying, man, that actually looks pretty good. Right? And he makes up his mind, I will go to my father, and I will say, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. He came to this reality of who he was. And he knew he wasn't worthy. He knew he hadn't done anything to deserve his father's mercy. So he said, just make me a servant. Make me a servant. That would be better than what I got going right now. And so he got up and went. There's a word that's really important in the Bible, and that's this word but, B-U-T. The Bible says in Luke 15 that as he was still a long ways off, his father saw him. His father saw him and ran to him and embraced him. I'm sure going through his mind, he was wondering, what is my father's response going to be? What is he going to say? Imagine probably the shock, the surprise as his father goes out to him, meets him before he can even get home, and embraces him. And then he begins his confession. Father, I've sinned against heaven, against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. What does the father say? There's that word but again. But the father said, bring the best robe. Put it on my son. Kill the fatted calf. We are going to have a celebration today. Because my son, who was lost, has now been found. Oh, what grace. Oh, what grace. This is what. There's only one way that this is possible. And that happened 2,000 years ago. God the Father took his anger and his hatred and his wrath, as the Bible calls it, upon his son on a cross. And the Son absorbed the wrath of God in our place. Died, rose again 3 days later, conquering sin and death. The Bible says whoever believes in him, believes in his work, will not perish but have everlasting life. And this can be true today. Wouldn't it be something that if someone were to come to some of you that are here in this room right now and say, oh, do you remember Dylan and Jessica's wedding, and you say, oh, I remember Dylan and Jessica's wedding. I remember that day. Because that day, Jesus found me. Jesus found me, and he gave me a robe, a robe. A new robe, a righteousness. The past washed away. Now I have the righteousness of the very Son of God upon me. And there was a feast that went far beyond. We're going to have a great feast and celebration here at the reception in a little bit, as soon as I shut up. Shortly after. Anyway. But the feast, I believe, that anybody here who surrenders their life to Jesus Christ here today is going to be different, because there's angels that are going to be with your heart. Because of the feast of one sinner, two sinners, three sinners, coming home to the Father and experiencing his grace. Amen?
Amen.
And so, Dylan and Jessica, commit yourselves to that. All the days of your life, as much time as God gives you here on this earth, commit yourself to the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Love, honor, comfort, cherish, and obey him
from this day forward, forsaking all others, holding only unto him, in sickness and in health, in joy and in sorrow, through the good times and the bad, for as long as you both shall live. If you then repeat your vows. Welcome to 2015.
Thank you. And as the years march along, like a beating heart, I will live these words till death do us part. 'Cause I have never been so sure of anything before, like I am.
Wedding ring, an unbroken circle, is a symbol of unending and unceasing commitment. May this ring be blessed, so he who gives it and she who wears it may abide in peace and continue in love until life's end. May this couple be prepared to continue to give, be able to forgive and experience more and more joy with each passing day. Dylan and Jessica are now beginning their married life together. We trust that they may have loving assistance from their families, the constant support of friends, and a long life with good health and everlasting love. In so much as Dylan and Jessica have consented to live throughout this life together in wedlock and have witnessed the same before this company, having given and pledged their faithfulness to one another, and have demonstrated the same by the giving and receiving of the rings, as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, I pronounce them husband and wife in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may now seal the promises you have made with each other with a kiss. Today, according to God's purpose and commandment, and in His eye, a man and a woman have become one flesh. Jesus said, what God has joined together, let no man separate. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Mr. and Mrs. Dylan Murphy.
Thank you.